Plus, we also had a vial of a little Benzedrine, like little M&Ms, on his desk for a reporter when people needed to make deadline. It was literally like a candy jar. But it was good times. I was in San Francisco and we were invited to see a rough cut of American Graffiti. When Lucas showed it over at Zoetrope, I got to see a rough cut of it because we were all invited. You know.
And were you interested in film at that point, or?
I was interested and terrified. I was always a theater kid. I was always directing, you know, plays, and writing journalism or writing anything. But I didn't know anything about exposure, and somehow the technological notion of that I would have to learn. And I remember once trying to thread a Bolex and just shredding the film and then trying to cut on a sink block and went, oh fuck. And I just never really learned until I then, you know, started to really learn.
Did you really learn? Did you learn, or have somebody doing it?
Well,
their hands on it for you.
Well, the funny thing is, with the way that Steve Rosenblum and I met at AFI was that was, I mean, I can back up for a second if you want, but the point is, neither of us knew anything about cutting, and every time I tried to make a cut on the sink block, I would rip the emulsion off the film, and I was going to, you know, I was making the cuts based on what frames were left because they wouldn't let us reprint. And he was there as the worst cinematographer in the history of AFI, and he knew he was going to, you know, not make that work, and so he said, well, maybe he's an editor, and so he figured out how to work the sink block, and then I didn't have to.
And it all came together.
Yeah, it was my student film, and he literally cut that and has cut everything ever since.
So was your student film like a 30-something episode? Was it?
Well, it is sort of more domestic. It had a slight sort of a magical realist quality to it, but it had Bobby Carradine and Melanie Griffith and a guy named Michael Conrad, who you might remember.
Oh yeah, the great Michael Conrad.
Who tortured me. He agreed to do it and then just basically tormented me for 2 weeks in Big Bear, saying, why am I doing this piece of shit, and am I being paid? And there's a great Michael Conrad story, which I don't know if I should tell on the air, but why not? Why not speak ill of the dead? But when we were doing 30-something, he was doing Hill Street, and they hated him. He was horrible to everyone. And then he got sick, and he had to leave the show, and he was gone for 6 months or more. And then when he came back, they were all convinced, oh, well, he's had this brush with death, he's in remission, he's going to be different, and he was worse.
Oh.
And he was worse. And they all started taking a pool as to when he would go.
That's fun.
Yeah.
That's the joy of Radford.
That's it, it was Radford. That's exactly right. But anyway.
So is it fair to say that you're the Michael and that Hershkowitz is the Elliot?
Nah.
This relationship?
No, I think not.
You've chosen to do some very hard, I mean, except for your first film.
Yeah.
You've done some, all your stuff has been very serious as a director.
Yeah, and I love, it's funny, it's weird because the comic stuff is stuff that I've so loved when we've done it, you know, in television. I think both are in that regard. It's and ego, maybe more than its personality and the other personality.
So that's just always worked for you together. You're still working together.
Yeah, I mean, the funny thing, but because we're guys who have some kind of issue of phallic identity and have needed to individuate sometimes, I've done a bunch of things alone, and he's done a bunch of things alone, and we've done a bunch of things together. You know, his first movie had nothing to do with me, this thing, Jack the Bear, and then I was involved helping him develop Dangerous Beauty, but didn't really produce it, and I've since, you know, this most recent movie really was mine throughout, and you know, he would read it and say something that made me upset and comment, but we've at times really sort of, you know,
under separate directions.
Yeah, but we're still, I mean, we've been close friends and continue to be for, it's almost 30 years now, and it's kind of like one long conversation. And it's a license to hang out. His office is right next door there, you know, and so things evolve, and it's never clear who's going to take what role, but it sort of happens organically.
So is Defiance the natural progression of the movies you've made? I mean, it seems like you can kind of see memories of other pictures, and this seems like a...
There are, it's funny, it's a little scary when you see that you've maybe trod some of the same ground, or you're evoking things. Well, it's hard, you know, chronology is hard because of the business. In other words, we optioned this 12 years ago, and it's taken a long time to get it made. So the interesting thing is, you know, it's never quite clear why you've made a movie until after you've made it. Mm-hmm. And even then, it sometimes takes some real time to have perspective. I knew that I'd made movies about you know, African Americans and Africans and Japanese and Arabs, and really had never talked about the Jews. Mm-hmm. And that was sort of glaring as an omission to me. So I know it was, in that sense, trying to, you know, look a little bit more inward and try to talk about something that had been important to me, and you know, became personal in that regard. It also became personal because I come from a family of some tough Jews. My father's father was one of five brothers in Chicago who were, what's a good word for this? They were bookies, really, but they were called betting commissioners, which meant that, you know, they were between City Hall and the mob. Itchke, Dovey, Fat, Zeus, and Zell, and Jules, I guess. And they're great stories that he used to tell me about them. I never knew them, but he used to tell me stories. And my other grandfather came from Poland and actually lost family, and he was that immigrant who made that rise to suburban affluence within his lifetime. And he was very present in my life. And, you know, to go there or to delve into this voice, if you will, it was a little bit like mother's milk.
Finding this, I mean, this material you've had for a while.
Yeah.
Was this always kind of the piece for you in terms of the storytelling?
Yeah, I mean, the funny thing is we didn't really crack it for a long time. Clay, when he wrote the first draft, and together we had developed it, was trying to tell all 3 years. And it became very diffuse. It didn't have any kind of real dramatic tension, and that dialectic between the idea of saving and vengeance was not necessarily really well enough vested in the characters. And and the sort of eureka moment was, it wasn't very long ago, it was maybe a couple of years ago now, when I said, you know, forget the exposition, forget the end. What if we sort of began in media res, if we began like these people running through a forest, or, you know, and really, and then also just get them through that first winter and then suggest what the future might be. And and that was the decision, to try to crack the story, to make it more of a movie story, at least, that could work within 2 hours.
But at that point, did you have the idea of the two brothers being the opposing?
Yeah, it would, but not, it hadn't like just taken on the breath of life. That happens to be taken from, as best we can judge, that's from the truth. You know, that there were those parallel strains, and that each of them had taken a polar sort of point of view.
There's always an odd conversation that people ask about the movie, and you go, well, it's about four brothers, but it's really kind of about two brothers.
Yeah, it's really, I mean, obviously that it's...
And Jamie's great, and the kid you found, you know...
He's lovely.
He's terrific, yeah.
You know, the interesting thing about the youngest brother is that he most recently became, I don't know if you know this story, but that he is now 84. He's the only one left alive. He was 11. He was recently indicted for trying to bilk a widow out of her retirement checks with his 75-year-old trophy wife, his Polish trophy wife.
Oh my God.
And people were so scandalized, and I was not surprised, because these guys were Bull Vaughn. They were, on the margins. And to me, that's the great part of the story, is that they were, you know, not just reluctant, but absolutely unexpected, you know, heroes.
There's actually a great documentary called Fighter, about two guys. One was Polish. They were near each other, and they became friends in the United States after the war was over. And they became good friends, and they go back to, at the behest of the documentarian, go back to retrace their steps and realize that they were on opposite sides.
Wow.
And want to become an informer for the Polish
home army or whatever.
Yeah.
Really?
And they're fighting as they're going through this and hating each other more and more.
Oh, that's really
fascinating.
Good. I love when that happens. It's like Sherman's March. The documentary thinks it's going to be about one thing and it turns out to be about another.
Yeah.
I love that. There was a famous story. There was a what's the name of the writer? Chaim Grod. This thing called The Quarrel, about the men who are in the cheder together in the little town, and they get they argue about the religious and the secular life, and they take that dialectic, and then they get taken to the camp, and they're in, you know, order of, they continue the same conversation, and then they're separated, each presume the other dead, and then they meet 15 years later on the streets of Paris and continue the argument, which I love.
Yeah. The Middle East will be settled really soon, I'm sure.
Yeah, exactly.
Piece of cake.
Yeah.
So does going back to, I mean, obviously there have been a lot of movies about the Holocaust.
Yeah.
I mean, is that intimidating to head to? Do you?
Very. I mean, I think when Clay first, I mean, Clay found this obituary in the New York Times, which is where it sort of began for us. And he said, well, here's a movie here. And I said, you know, I mean, who are we to presume to talk about what, not just the greatest filmmakers, but the greatest scholars and philosophers and other people, what is there to add? Mm-hmm. But what was remarkable to me is how much there was to add about this particular notion. You know, resistance, for any number of reasons, and we can talk about why, you know, has somehow, with the absence of the Warsaw Ghetto, been outside of the conventional wisdom, not understood to be, in fact, as common and as ubiquitous as it was. And as we began to sort of go through the looking glass and do into the new scholarship, of which there's a lot, what you discovered is that the impulse was everywhere. And so it's suggested that there was more, it was kind of adding necessary complexity to a portrait. Because, you know, as time passes and things begin to be understood as being more monolithic, to be understood as being monolithic is to be able to objectify. And when you can objectify a group, that leads to all sorts of very, you know, unhappy results. So I think to give this other parallax, this view, was really important to me. And I felt that that could be, you know, a different way in and a different perspective on something that people presume to know. And also, it also, to me, had a lot to do with talking about heroism of a kind that is different. That, you know, we're in the hero business, right? You know, and inevitably, or what seems to be increasingly happening, is that people invent them. Why do they invent them? They invent them because to look at a real hero is to look at something very complex and not necessarily as becoming as you might like. So instead, you create Batman and Superman and Iron Man and, you know, whatever man, but no ordinary man.
Right.
And to say, well, what was it? How did, you know, because in my experience, when Denzel and I did Courage Under Fire, we met these guys who won the Medal of Honor, or the people who in fact are heroes are often, there's some quality of shame attached to it, there's reticence, there's even a kind of a real refusal to address what might have happened, that things were impetuous or just fun, you know. And so I kind of went, oh, well, there's another reason to tell this story about, you know, something that people hadn't really imagined.
Well, that theme has really defined your work as a film director. Interestingly, in television, the stuff has, it's very human and very intimate.
Yeah.
But not pushing that as much.
That's right.
But it seems like the thematic thing, you know, through Courage Under Fire, through, you know.
It's fair enough
through
to say.
Story, through the terrorist movie.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
All, you know, the outside view of the people.
Right.
Versus the inside view, completely different.
Yeah, I guess that's true. I mean, you know, in the intimate description of relationships, and particularly in the socialized, decorous world, which is self-conscious and much more ambivalent, modern life and men and women and partners and with people not in extremis, you know, they equivocate and find very gray areas. And I guess I'm drawn in the larger canvas in the same way that, you know, dramatists much greater than I have always been drawn, you know, that sort of Homeric attempt to say, who are people when they are stripped away of all those ambiguities, to try to confront. I think it allows it allows me at least to try to frame a conversation about some more elemental questions, whether they're moral questions or political questions. That feels to me a more almost like rhetorical opportunity in some way.
I've always said over the years about your work, which occasionally has driven me crazy, in a good way.
Well, I've actually read, I went back and I read some of the stuff you've written, David, and you're kind of sweet.
You let me in the office.
I did. Well, no, what you say is that you're engaged in the good ideas, and then I vex you by being too tidy or
you make, to me, it's always that choice in the third act of who's right, in a way, which
right.
I think you make more as a style, you know, I feel it in the style of the filmmaking more than necessarily in the
It's a fair criticism. In some cases, you're conceding to the economics, I think, when in the studio system, that the pressure in the past in certain cases has been very intense, or the movie star's pressure to do it has been intense, and there's a certain concession to that. On the other hand, some of it's my own weakness for shape or for some feeling of closure or resolution, which I guess is maybe as much about genre as anything else, but it's fair comment. I guess to me, having evoked one problem is maybe having too successfully evoked an antithesis, that then to try to pose anything that seems resolution is deflating in some way or frustrating.
Well, it's interesting discussing it with you because it's a choice of that ambiguity. It's a choice of the fact that the right choice may be the wrong choice, and the wrong choice may be the right choice.
Right, right.
You know, I go back to watching when it just opened the Century City Theaters, watching Legends of the Fall, and as a heterosexual male, I think we all wanted to have sex with Brad Pitt at the end of that. And we're like beating ourselves to death, though, at the same time, because how do we pick this asshole?
Right.
Who would cheat on his brother's, with his brother's wife and do this to somebody.
Yeah.
And yet we were in love with him.
That's right.
Because of your work.
Well, he is fetishized a little bit, and that's true. On the other hand, to me, it was, I don't know, it's funny, because what approaches. To me, it was also about the wounds that a man takes on in the course of his life and how he becomes the accumulation of that and the damage that is sown. But that movie came to me out of, it was really Jim Harrison's, almost like this oral tale told. It was an opportunity to do this narrative that was, and then 7 years passed, and then 10 years passed. It was very much like that sort of that Norse tale, Native American tale, and that usually is about these people who inspire like awe and dread, but not necessarily sympathy. And yet, the result of sometimes a movie star presented in a particular way is indeed to engage that kind of identification. It's kind of counterintuitive.
Well, I think we did hate. I'm having brain damage now.
It's okay.
Hated
who? Aiden?
No, Hannibal.
Yes. Oh, Tony.
Tony Scott.
Hopkins. Yeah.
Tony Hopkins. Yeah. We definitely did hate him.
Yeah. Good. Right.
Though he's very lovable in real life.
But. Yeah, it's true.
So in this case, Liev and Daniel give very different performances. Obviously, they're playing different sides of the coin on some level, but very different stylistic performances as well.
You see? Do you feel them to be in different movies,
I just feel like Liev is very, very method, I guess. Mm-hmm. There's a sense of him really, for me, was really seeing him lost in that character.
Which is a great thing for me.
Good thing, yes.
Oh, yeah.
It's a brilliant performance.
I'm proud of that,
And Daniel is holding he holds the ground in a way he probably didn't do before he did Bond. Mm-hmm. But he has this kind of weight to him and this very simple, clean elegance to his performance.
Well, it's a good, they're both theater trained. They're the same age, Liev is really, perceived by many to be sort of the leading light of the theater at this moment, and certainly Daniel's had this apotheosis as Bond.
Great before Bond. I mean,
his
best theater, his best film work, I think, is
Layer Cake Bond, Mother Mother and The Infamous and all that stuff. I agree.
Enduring Love.
Right. But for each of them had different challenges, which was interesting, because Liev, I'd loved his work in the theater, But to my mind, I'd never seen him arise to that same level of size and expression that I had seen on the stage. I felt mm-hmm. him constrained and oddly contorted in his film work. Mm-hmm. And it was very interesting to encourage him and to work toward a much more intuitive, because he's so brilliant. Mm-hmm. He's so capable of any number of different things, to just viscerally commit. And the nature of what we were doing, the speed at which we had to shoot, mm-hmm. and the lack of money and time, it obliged him to have to just give voice to that instinct. Mm-hmm. And so too is the character instinctive. So you get this thing of a real sort of volatile thing. And for Daniel, you know, the moral center of a movie is inevitably, in some sense, it's the expressions on both sides are more prescribed. And what I like about what he does, to me, is he is not just fallible, but to me, deeply sort of uncertain. Mm-hmm. That he makes wrong choices. He seems not taking the reins, you know, at every moment with great right. clarity and power. When he even makes that sort of mission statement, decides to sort of take charge as you see them all arguing, it mm-hmm. sort of comes out of this fulminating thing. There's some humility mm-hmm. in that performance that I like. And that also suggests to me why they then didn't talk about it. He killed his own people. He did these things. You know, like a lot of people who have done stuff like that, like even that whole generation of World War II, mm-hmm. the guys that I know, the men that I've known, don't talk about it. And that I felt was, it's actually a generous performance mm-hmm. that allows Liev to rise up and has Jamie have those moments. I mean, I'll even tell you a good story about that, which is that I think when I wrote it, one of the earliest drafts, that moment when before they go into the swamp, which is also based on true story about them crossing this horrible swamp, that moment was Daniel's as I might have imagined at first mm-hmm. in early draft. You know, we will not, you know, be, and it was that sort of the ringing vibrato and team, and I realized no, that's not the character. But he'd already signed on to make the movie, and now I've got to go to the movie star and say, you know, that third act moment, you know, you know, because I hadn't really well enough described Jamie's arc, and I think mm-hmm. that I realized that would be his coming of age. And to Daniel's credit, the minute I said, he went, done, great, perfect. Mm-hmm. And I know a lot of other actors, and I won't name names, who would have said, you know, they somehow find a way of putting themselves in front of the movie mm-hmm. and thereby inhibit it from becoming an ensemble. I think one is, and I don't know if he'll get the credit for this as people look at that performance, but I think his willingness to disappear into the ensemble is what allows it to have some feeling of the breath of life, yeah. at least the other actors.
Well, the choice of his character seems, to his character, unnatural. Whereas Liev seems perfect, that's who they are, kind of.
Right.
The Renegades are easier. I mean, I think Liev's performance is stunning.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's somehow much more natural to those brothers to be that person than to be
that's
a
right.
leader who has to be there and
right.
know, be the face of things. And
that's right. I think that's true.
It's brutal for them.
Yeah, yeah.
So how long did you have to shoot? How long did you shoot this film?
61 days.
So was that a terrible hardship? Was it?
Well, I mean, when you're trying to, we try to do ambitious things. You always stretch the, you know. I mean, we, you know, had the resources we had. They wrote us a check, and mm-hmm. there wasn't going to be another dime more. So we just did with what we had. I think when you're really trying to have a certain amount of action and a certain amount of you know, you have to remember we were in Lithuania up. By you know the Baltic near Finland, and it was already getting to winter, so it wouldn't be light till 7:30 in the morning, mm-hmm. and it was already starting to get dark in the forest at 4:30, mm-hmm. and so there was no lunch. We had a running lunch. Mm-hmm. Eduardo, we shot 1:85 so as to gain stops and mm-hmm. push the film two stops. I mean, we were, you know, it was a very sort of run and gun thing. Mm-hmm. But I mean, the thing about Daniel, which was so great. I mean, he was, if he had a trailer, he didn't know where it was. He was just there, you know, he's this mm-hmm. sort of working class British actor, which is like, I'm just there to do the work, and what do you need, and okay, and let's do it.
Well, I talked to a lot of actors on the other side of it and talked to them about what they look for in directors and, you know, whether they, how the relationship is built. I mean, for you, do you, again, a lot of your work has had the ensemble feel, but you've had big movie stars, you've had all that. Do you go to people and say, okay, look, you're going to have to be part of a team and not just a movie star?
Well, I don't think I've ever said it,
right.
But maybe it's, it may be understood at a certain moment. I mean, I think that I'm interested, I am interested in movie stars, obviously, because I've worked with a lot of them, but I'm interested in them as actors. Mm-hmm. They began as actors before they were movie stars, and they had something in intrinsic that somehow became that. In many cases, that they may have lost some touch with. Mm-hmm. But I tend to be interested in those ways of using them that may be a little off-center and, you know, and a little unexpected.
Mm-hmm.
Or the challenges them in a particular way. I mean, you know, DiCaprio, who's so ambitious artistically, the challenge of that South African accent, mm-hmm. the challenge of that character, and the challenge of playing the sort of the anti-hero and the, you know, the way that Henry Fonda would choose to do Fort Apache, mm-hmm. or, you know, some romantic lead to play a mm-hmm. antithesis to that. I think that has an appeal to these guys.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's also the only way that I've found that I could ever get to make the movies about this subject that I want to make. Because we used to think that we were, you know, giving away the store when the actors got all this power. But in fact, if the actors didn't want to make these movies, they would never be made. None of them. The studio does not want to make movies like this at all.
You're one of the few people still making studio dramas.
Trying.
I mean, there are not a lot of those being made, period.
There aren't. There aren't. And it was a staple. It was one of the great venerable traditions of Hollywood, and it's not just, I mean, obviously I'll make dramas however I can make them at whatever scale, but scale with drama
mm-hmm.
is a thing that is all but gone, you know.
So it's gotten harder to find a way to do these
things. This movie was, we financed it independently, we only came to Vantage, you know, to distribute,
right?
So that's the only way it happened. It wouldn't have happened otherwise.
So mostly it happened because foreign money was willing to buy into Daniel and willing to buy into,
I think it was the fact that the fact that
a little bit.
No, I think it actually, you know, in all modesty, it's because the last three movies I've done have done much better foreign than they've done domestically, and that has a certain, you know, specific gravity there. And of course Daniel on the come mm-hmm. as James Bond. I don't think they wanted to make it about Jews and the Holocaust as much as with those other things.
Right, which is why he's front and center on the poster.
You know, yes. Although the interesting thing is in Europe, the Europeans.
Mm-hmm.
The European poster is the three of them.
Hmm. What's funny, I always remember going, you go to Europe and you see movie posters, and it's like
the
flip side of the American, you know, it's all of a sudden the interpreter is a Sean Penn movie and not a Nicole Kidman movie.
That's right, exactly. Yeah, and it's very interesting when you go sell a movie now, mm-hmm. because, you know, it used to be the tail wagging the dog, now the tail is the dog.
Mm.
I mean, you know, it's two times or two and a half times the revenue, and and, you know, you'd think that would encourage them to be more ambitious in some of their subject matter, to give it some more intellectual content or ideas, or whatever, mm-hmm. but it's had the opposite effect.
But even at the studios, I mean, Samurai, I don't know if Samurai was split or not at Warner Brothers, but it was, and Blood Diamond, I don't know if that was split, but it was there.
No, neither were split.
But they would, these days, they would never make any of those movies without splitting.
I think that's probably true. I think that's exactly right. I mean, and by the way, in the absence of hedge funds having money now, who are they going to split it with?
That's a good question.
That's the real question.
We're about to find out.
We're going to find out big time.
So you've also delved into the internet world with the Quarter Life.
Yeah, yeah.
So was that just a fun lark, or was that...
No, it was political, I think. I mean, Marshall really was the leading the charge on that. But, you know, I think what we've had in television, which has been so, you know, heady, has been creative freedom.
Mm-hmm.
We've been able to write what we want, and it's been like a little repertory company. We write it, we shoot it, we do it.
Mm-hmm.
We are very happy to have conversations, but have not had to take notes. And what's happened in television post the FCC
mm-hmm.
doctrine,
mm-hmm.
Which is allowing the network's ownership of all their product, because they can own it, they now feel the right, and I suppose it is their right, to tell you what color to make the wallpaper
mm-hmm.
and who to choose to cast and what storylines. Mm-hmm. And that's just unacceptable to us creatively. And it was really born out of some like a lot of things have been born in our life, out of fuck you. Mm-hmm. All right, we're going to try to find a different way. And, you know, the real fact of it is that the model isn't quite there yet. It's going to be there. Mm-hmm. We put our own money into it. We got our money back. We didn't make a dime. It's like, you know, there's that expression, you never want to be a pioneer because it's always the early Christian that gets the hungriest lion. But we got to do what we wanted to do. Mm-hmm. We did this thing, and we enjoyed doing it, and who knows whether it will continue to live. We're still trying to see if we can, you know, have the site continue, because the site had these other aspects to it.
But you're comfortable to be a model. I mean, there are a few people in this business who played all fields, as you have through your career.
Right.
You know, so you've had your fingers in the television side, the movie side, the producing, the directing, writing. You see a model coming?
Oh, well, yeah, but I'm not sure. I mean, it's going to be so much about how to differentiate and have that product seen amidst this world of stimuli. And the stimuli, because I've got a 16-year-old home and a 22-year-old, and I've watched them try to differentiate from games to you know, net stuff, to streaming, to the one of the biggest drains against the movie business have been the accumulation of television episodes aggregated as DVDs, and the vast inventory of that has suddenly appeared on the market every year. If that's 22 hours that's competing with the DVD of something else, that's been a real one. I'm afraid inevitably it'll be something having to do with the Time Warner subscription series that includes, you know, you pay this and you get this. And
right.
The real question will be when that technology is so cheap in terms of that home size flat screen, you know, when the experience, when people are trying to make it day and date, and, you know, what effect it'll have on the actual, you know, intellectual property. Mm-hmm. In other words, they want, in order to save advertising costs, they want it crunched more and more and more to only spending the money once.
Right.
What they want, because they're spending so much money, they want something to appeal to all four quadrants, as they say, you know that phrase. What's the legacy of that? The legacy of that, what can appeal to men and women over 30 and under 30 of all four quadrants? The least interesting, most available, accessible material. Mm. That's why you're getting the product that you're getting.
Well, and the fewest, ultimately, the fewest number of films.
Exactly.
I mean, how can you have more than one film a week if you're going to try to open to $60, $70 million each time?
Exactly.
It limits the whole.
Yeah.
So, I mean, will you be doing Defiance 2 on a stage somewhere with, you know, with fake plants in
the
background?
Yeah, will we all, those of us who want to make anything interesting, will we become the sort of quaint equivalent of opera? You know, I mean,
it is that bad.
Well, that's a fair question. You know, it's a fair question if you're doing what you want to do, and there are those who love it and can gain from it. I mean, you know what it is? I'll tell you why. Because I'm interested in popular culture, and popular culture is the means, for better or worse, by which particularly young people have gained a worldview. And in fact, in the absence of really reading serious history or real literature, it's filling in for that. And I remember when Kurt Vonnegut was asked, why do you write these books for, you know, 21-year-olds? He said, well, in my experience, by the time someone reaches their 30s, they're already the asshole they're going to be for the rest of their lives. And they're not listening.
Mm-hmm.
And that is what film culture has been. It was for me when I was 18, going to, you know, and being rocked by movies and then talking all night. And and for better or worse, history and social politics and all that stuff is gleaned from some kind of engagement with the form.
Mm-hmm.
And that's free television, studio movies, you know, rock concerts. I mean, popular culture is it just can't be surrendered entirely to the demographers and the marketeers.
But how do we get them to watch the right thing?
Well, that's money that they use to call their attention. That's the problem.
I mean, for me, I learned more about film sitting in the movie theater at Northwestern, watching, you know, two films a day, three times a week at the Varsity.
I was in Cambridge. I went to the Orson Welles in the Brattle, and that was it.
But they don't exist anymore. Even at university towns, they don't exist.
You know, and the irony is that DVDs exist in such abundance. You know, the Criterion Collection, the Janus catalog. I mean, that's all so available. Mm-hmm. I gotta say, my son is actually starting to get into this a lot, but.
Of course, he's your son.
Yeah, you're right. It's fair. I mean, it's not in the ritual. It's somehow not part of the habit. Mm-hmm. He he's just as happy to then sit and look at the collection of the first year of The Office on his computer, mm-hmm. which wasn't available. So, I mean, I think a lot about movies too. That when you saw a movie, you knew, or you somehow suspected, you were only going to get to see it once in your life. And that incredible engagement mm-hmm. was so passionate and so attentive. There was no, oh, well, I'll be able to get the DVD, or I'll see it 10 more times on HBO.
Right.
It was ephemeral. Mm-hmm. And so it galvanized you to have this very immediate, or you went back to it again the next night, and that's different.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's interesting they have these Blu-ray things now, this BD Live system, you can actually do instant messaging while you're watching the movie.
Oh, perfect.
And it actually syncs them up. So if kids are watching Sleeping Beauty, has it, where one kid's watching in Santa Monica and one kid's watching in Hollywood.
They're watching at the same time.
The movie will sync over the internet, and then they can actually text each other back and forth or play competitive trivia games and all that kind of stuff.
That seems to be the institutionalization of ADD.
If they're watching Sleeping Beauty for the 20th time.
That's true.
Which the kids do now. I mean, it's like such a completely different mindset.
Yeah.
When you talk about that. Because I remember when HBO started, it was kind of shocking.
Yeah.
And you saw the same movies over and over again, and then some of them you never saw again. But, you know, how many times did I watch Animal House on HBO?
It's true. It's true. But then again, it wasn't quite like going to see the Rocky Horror Picture Show at midnight.
No.
With a group, or The Harder They Come, that played for 400 years, or King of Hearts. You know, all those movies. That was a communal experience.
So, do you go to the movies a lot yourself still?
Sure.
Do you go to regular movies? Do you go to screenings?
I don't like screenings as much because mm-hmm. it's everyone sitting there with such schadenfreude saying, you know, oh, I hope they fail, and they're leaning back. It's kind of horrible. Mm-hmm. I do like to go to the movies. I mean, you know, now that my youngest is finally of an age where we're not having to stay home as much, mm-hmm. I hope that, like me, a lot of my generation will go to more movies. But I do like going to the movies.
Do you go to art house movies primarily, or do you go to mainstream stuff?
I mean, I tend to, there's less mainstream stuff to see that I like.
Yeah.
I go to mostly art house movies.
And is the experience going into the theater what it was 10 years ago? It certainly wasn't what it was 20 years ago, I don't think.
Right. I mean, I think it depends. I mean, I remember going to see, you know, going to see Man on a Wire recently, and just kind of having this wonderful experience. And, you know, I mean, you know, that's a really good question. I don't know.
I think in saying Man on a Wire, it's a movie that people so love. I think love is love.
Yeah.
And the medium stuff, I think, is but
that's
when
right.
people really love something, it's it is palpable stuff.
Yeah, and but also good is not good enough these days.
Yeah.
It's gotta be great. And that's the problem, because there's less ambition to do things. Movies, it means something on a cellular level to me about the experience of sitting there.
Yeah.
And that's never gonna change.
Roger Ebert used to argue about the idea of digital projection versus regular projection, and that one put you in a state of reverie and one put you in a coma, essentially. But he actually felt like the film itself was part of the.
Well, it's an interesting question about luminosity and what that is and how that's achieved. It's gotten a lot closer recently. Although we have a lot of, I still want to have show prints of the movie, and we still have them. It's not all digital.
So when you have your opening day, which is the different opening day that you had,
yes,
but you still have an opening day.
Yes, we do.
Are you going to have the butterflies in the stomach on Friday afternoon waiting for numbers, or did you make the movie and?
Well, I mean, the thing is, the stakes financially are they're always serious, but there's a little bit less of a sphincter factor, I think, because the whole budget is $30 million, and they pre-sold a lot of it to Europe, so the gap is less. Now, in order to accomplish that, I had to take a quarter of my salary, and Daniel took a quarter of his, and my whole crew worked for nothing, and I gave part of my piece to Steve Rosenblum and James Newton Howard and to Eduardo Serra, and because we did it together. So I would like the movie to do well financially so that they could get their full fee and I could get more of my fee. It would be nice. I would like that. But it's not as much about, oh God, is it going to topple the towers of Burbank, if it doesn't open.
Right.
And there's something nice about that, I think.
And for you aesthetically, is it that you've done the film and that's what is important, that you look at the piece that you made and the art is done and the commercial part is another hat? Or is it all
a... That's a really good question. I think actually what I found is this is a way of answering it, I think, but a little bit different. I mean, because I've made 10 movies or done this many years, what you discover is that in fact it's not about the opening weekend or the reviews or the awards or anything. It's only about time. That there are movies that I've made that over time have gained in luster and others that have lost it. And they have there's no relationship to how they did in any of those other categories necessarily. And what you come to understand is that whether it digs in to the culture or not is the final arbiter. And we've become so focused as a society about money and increasingly about awards, as if, to put artists in competition with one another, it's the most destructive thing you could ever do, is to take a piece that you feel good about and then stigmatize it by imagining that it's now gonna lose or that it's less good than someone else's art. And that's just so destructive to all of us, and to the business, I think. But the fact is, I really never go back and look at the movies. I can't say I've ever. I mean, every now I'll come home and I'll see that a kid has found a video and I'll hear some music and what is that? And they'll be looking at something and I'll stand in the back and look at it for a bit. But the nature of making a movie now is you've so gone. There's so much redundancy in the cuts and the previews and the prints and the screenings and whatever. You don't really want to, all you can look at is what doesn't work, but something else is with this one, which has been very different and very interesting to me. We screened it at YIVO last week in New York. And at the end of the screening, two men got up and said, I was in the forest. And you've told the story of our lives. My children will now understand something. I thought that I would never have it known. We're going to screen it again in New York, where we've now found that there are 18 living members of our Otriad in around America, and then 45 of other, because they were in forests all over Europe. They're going to be there, and you say, "Whoa, this is strong medicine. This is actually goes beyond any of the things we're talking about," And I have to say that's gratifying. And there have been kids who've come up to me now, 30-year-old men, saying, well, I was 14 when I saw Glory, and it made me be interested in history, and now I'm an associate professor at, Grinnell. And I can imagine, when I was that 17-year-old Jewish kid in the Midwest, and I was confronted only with World War II images of skeletons and striped pajamas and barbed wire, that to have this image as well might have meant something to me. So possibly somewhere there's going to be some kid for whom this will have this meaning. I don't know what the legacy of it will be. And that again goes beyond the temporal things that we're forced to focus on, because it's an economic medium and because we're in a narcissistic society, and because we're all in this orgy of self-congratulation, which is the Oscar, all that shit. Yeah. I mean, Hollywood always finds a way to make you feel bad about something that you might have otherwise felt that's the spike in the arm.
But your story is about men making a choice and doing something for other people that doesn't have all... There are no Academy Awards for being in the forest.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true.
And I think that's what still touches us. I think when you look at the films that people are talking about, you know, this time of year, mm-hmm. even a movie like, you know, Slumdog Millionaire, which couldn't be any further away from your movie than that, it's still the story of somebody, you know, moving forward in life and chasing what they, you know.
Well, look, I'd like to think that we've had a week now in America where that divide, which has been so revealed, has in fact maybe tipped a little bit. Because if there's any subtext to what the Obama campaign was, it was some humanist value, some notion of attaching to something larger than oneself, mm-hmm. That sacrificed, the finer angels of our nature are somehow each, you know, connected to other people. And that, at least for the moment, has had its expression. Now, it's one thing even as a kind of fashionable or a cult of personality to be expressed once, mm-hmm. whether it can now find its support to do all the things it needs to do. But that is the same thing that you just articulated to me.
Yeah.
So.
Well, hope is not easy, but it's doable. It's a possibility.
Right. That's right. Yeah. And
I don't know how else we live if we don't continue to believe that somehow.
That's exactly right. And by the way, that is also a kind of resistance, which is to say, it's not just taking up arms, it's keeping faith, bearing witness, doing or making films that you care about or believe in at the expense of popular vogue and taste. I mean, this is just my own crackpot theory, but there's a nihilism in the critical community that is so suspicious of anything that aspires to engender the finer selves or emotion,
mm-hmm.
and you see it because, you know, whether it's because that voice is embarrassed or doesn't want to reveal itself or is cynical about being manipulated. I don't know why, and mm-hmm. you would know why because you've got to see all the movies all the time. I mean, you probably.
Well, I've stopped seeing the bad ones, so I'm actually relatively sane.
Okay, that's good. You know, but.
No, I think you're absolutely right about that. I think critics, for whatever reasons, have decided that if it makes them, I would say, if it makes them feel something, they have to hate it.
That's it. It's like obligatory, and it's like we can no longer describe a happy man. That's forbidden. You know, but if we can find something that is brutal and that is in some sense denying some aspect of the human spirit, well then that's got to be real, that's got to be true, because it is the world too, it is in the world, but it's that divide I'm talking about.